Thank you for having me. I'm very excited of giving a seminar online. Unfortunately, I've only been to Nottingham once to change trains. So hopefully at some point I can see it like for a little bit more than half an hour. Okay, so this is work on construction of compact spaces that parameterize, or compact moduli spaces that parameterize log Fano pairs. And it's very explicit, so it has a lot of, or to me, it has a lot of feeling of classical birational geometry when it comes to proofs. Maybe not so much in this talk, but when you are actually doing the proofs, you have to work a lot with the varieties, which makes it quite nice. So our, ooh, didn't expect this to, okay. Our moduli problem is going to be to describe compactifications of some families of log Fano pairs, and by families I mean with a geometric meaning. Okay, so we are really aiming for compact moduli, and we don't want an abstract construction. We want something that we can actually work with. So the problem is that when you go to higher dimensions or varieties which are fairly complicated, this is not so easy, obviously, because you don't have. I mean, if you cannot say much about, say, hypersurfaces of degree 100 in dimension 200, it's kind of hard to give any good classification. So GIT comes to the rescue in some way. So it's good because it's easy to describe what's in the moduli, at least with equations for its variety. Okay. Easy to construct and easy to classify. So it's a lot of good. And then, so this would be less good. Then there's the bad, that is hardly ever modular. Hardly ever modular in the sense that at the boundary you may have things that they don't really have much to do with what you started with. I think a canonical example of this is if you do the compactification of the GIT compactification of degree 4 curves in P2 of cortex. This has a point inside here represented, which is a double conic, yeah, which doesn't really feel like a quartic in any reasonable sense. It's a non-reduced quartic. Okay. All right. So I should be able to give myself new pages here. Let me see if I remember how this is going. I've done this before. Okay, if I cannot do this, it's gonna be a very short talk. No, that's not what I wanted. This yesterday.
What happens if you swipe to the side?
Oh, like that? Not much. Release to add new page. Yeah, that's what they tried earlier. I don't know why it didn't work. Okay. So part two of this is GIT of hypersurfaces. So I know GIT for a lot of people is something they know very well, and for others is something they've only heard about. So GIT stands for geometric invariant theory, and I'll talk a little bit about one example, which is the one we will use. So let D to be polynomials, hypersurfaces in Pn given by homogeneous polynomials of fixed degree. So we can think of these Fs as living in as being sections of Pn of the degree D Lyman bundle in Pn. Okay, and notice that we have the group SLM plus one acting on Pn, and that induces an action on this space, which I'm gonna go and call Carly H, or maybe, hang on, no. Maybe, okay, so since multiplying by a constant doesn't really affect the zero locus of the polynomial, we can think of F having a class living here, and I'm gonna call this space H, okay. So SLM plus one, the action on the variables of Pn induces an action on the polynomial, so SLM plus one acts on H. Okay. So GIT gives a natural compactification of, well, natural, maybe not so natural, let's say just a compactification of the space of smooth hypersurfaces, okay? And by the way, these are not Fano. Like, if the moment that D is bigger than n plus one, this is not Fano anymore. But we'll see why we can think of it as the pair Pn D being log Fano. So this compactification is canonically constructed as a quotient, and it really is the product of some of same bigger or equal than zero of it's zero of H O of M invariant by SLM plus one as M grows. So it's projective. Okay. And in terms of orbits, what it does is it classifies closed semi-stable orbits with finite stabilizers. So the semi-stable bit is just like a technical bit that means that the it cannot have very bad degenerations by one parameters approach. Okay, and the good thing of this is that you can actually do a lot of computations for this, even automatize. Like I have a program that you give the n and the d, and it just tells you everything that is not in this quotient, that is not represented in this. It's not represented in the semi-stable points. So you know that everything in the semi-stable points is the quotient of this. So it's very computational. And in fact, the moment you have, so it's very computational in the sense it tells you, you know, which polynomials are in, which polynomials are not. And if you have good classification of singularities and good deformation theory, in the sense that you know what things they form to, and you don't have many abstractions from local to global, then you can say a lot of about what's inside. And in fact, we have a well-known classifications for nd small. So for instance, I'm writing too big here. So for instance, if nd is in, what's better, thin or thick for reading?
I think I would prefer the thicker one.
Oh, okay. Never mind. Okay, so we have for 2-3, so cubic, plane cubic curves, quartic curves, quintics, sextics, and higher dimension. We also have for, of course, cubic surfaces, quartic surfaces, quintic surfaces partially. By Gallardo, we have a almost complete classification. In higher dimensions, I know we have cubic threefolds and cubic fourfolds, and there probably are others. I don't really know, but I suspect more than this is probably complicated for one person alone to obtain. Okay. Why don't you let me do this? I mean, Okay, good. Okay. So the reason why this is computable is because in GIT, semi-stable orbits are detected by the action of Hilbert-Mumford, by the action of one parameter subgroups and the Hilbert-Mumford weight of them, of one parameter subgroups acting on points in my scheme that I'm trying to take a coefficient on. So we will normally see in this setting this semi-stable if and only if this Hilbert-Mumford weight is positive, non-negative, or maybe I should say, okay, so it's semi-stable if it's, it's stable if it's positive, it's semi-stable if it's non-negative for all lambda one parameter subgroups of SLN. Okay. So, but as I said, the bad thing of this is that you may find polynomials that are in your compactification that are representing things that you didn't really want to start with. So, smooth quartic curves and the boundary. I mean, of course, it will have some with a little bit singular singularities on them, but also something like non-reduced a double conic. Okay, so this brings me down to K-stability, which is a theory that really comes from analytic, global analytic geometry. So the setting is gonna be to take a log Fano pair. So that means that minus kx minus one minus beta d is ample, okay? And I'm gonna choose my beta to be 0, 1. So if you find the beta confusing, it's just to allow me to, so beta is gonna play the role of a stability condition, although we are not gonna vary it much really, or we're gonna vary it in a way that the result doesn't change. Okay. So if you take beta to be 1, that means that you don't have divisor and you're just with a usual Fano variety. Okay, so we start with a pair like this, and we say that the test configuration of this pair is a C star log pair, so that's a pair with a C star action, and curly X, curly D, and C star equivariant flat proper C star equivariant morphism such that C star equivariant morphism such that curly X restricted, curly D restricted to any fiber is XD for B different than 0, and curly D, it's for this morphism, it's kind of like you know, you don't have fibers in curly D, so this is a equidimensional. So think of this. think of this as a degeneration, if you want, of X and D, only that you have a copy of X and D everywhere apart from at zero, and at zero you may have something a little bit nastier, so maybe even not reduced. Okay, you only know that this is flat. So, but everywhere else is just a copy of X and D. Okay. Right. So why do we care about this? So the first thing to note is that if I have, say, XD contains some big projective space, then and lambda is a one parameter subgroup of SLM plus one, then lambda induces one of these test configuration by taking the orbit of this action. So, you know, T is in C star, and every time you do, you apply T, you can send XD somewhere else by an action of SLM plus one with lambda T. So we're just going to take the closure of that, okay, and you're going to restrict it to C. So you're going to throw away the infinity fiber, and that naturally gives you a test configuration. However, not all test configurations arise this way. And the reason for that is because in the definition, we are not assuming we have a global ambient space, okay? Because we cannot have a global PN. We cannot have, in principle, a global PN where all test configurations live in. So essentially, I cannot say that S curly D is containing PN cross P one for all possible test configuration. Of course, for each of them, you're gonna find one, but there's no uniform way of embedding them all in principle. Okay, so now, hang on, before I get into this, so why am I, what's the relation between this and G and T? Obviously, test configurations, some of them come from one parameter subgroups. And there's something else that brings me back to GIT, that we have something known as the Donaldson-Futaki invariant, which is some invariant of the test configuration, which depends on, depending on action on the central fiber and the Hilbert polynomial. I'm not going to write it down because it's kind of technical and it doesn't really bring much to this talk. Just imagine that for every test configuration you put, you can get a number, and we call that number the Donaldson-Futaki invariant. It depends on beta. If you change beta, the number changes, but it's like an affine function on beta, or a linear function if you don't mind displacing it from zero. Okay, and then we say, I got the trick of getting a new page. So we say that a pair XD, a pair X comma one minus beta D is K stable if and only if the Donaldson-Futaki is bigger than zero for all non-trivial test configurations. We say it's K polystable if and only if it's bigger than zero for all non-equivariantly trivial test configurations, and is K semi-stable if and only if is bigger or equal than zero for all test configuration. Now the word trivial, I'm wrapping something under the carpet here. It's a little bit subtle what you mean by trivial, and there are some oddities on it, but I'd rather not get into that because, again, it doesn't really bring me anything to understand what follows. What we seem to have clearly is that K-stable implies K-polystable, K-polystable implies K-semistable, because the restriction is just simpler. Okay. So if curly X, curly D is induced from a one parameter subgroup lambda into some SLM plus one, the funny thing is that the Donaldson-Futak invariant of this is a constant times the Hilbert-Mumford weight for D, when I'm thinking of D as a hypersurface of some Pn. Okay, different end here. Okay. Yeah. And this is quite useful because you can see how in many ways you can think of K stability as a generalization of EIT. There is some relation between this analytic geometry that I mentioned. Maybe I should write that Saint Donaldson soon completed a proof started by many others, including some of them. X is K polystable Fano if and only if X admits. Okay, so maybe. X is Fano, and then X is K poly, Fano, smooth Fano. X is K polystable if and only if X admits a Kähler-Einstein metric. And there are singular versions of this that complicate matters a bit, if only to cite everyone involved. So I'll skip that. But that's where the story came from. So K stability was born as a way to try to decide when a Kähler-Einstein metric exists by algebraic methods, and in fact, it's been very successful in that sense. Okay, but from the moduli perspective, what we really care about, or what really inspires this work, is a theory by Odaka and Li Wang Chu independently, which says that Q Gorenstein smoothable K polystable Fano varieties form a compact moduli space. Okay. And I think what we were trying to do is, can we do something similar so this theorem of these guys doesn't really say much about what's the nature of the establishing the moduli space, what's K polystable, what is not, and in fact it's a very difficult problem to decide even for some special varieties, because you know, you see here that you have to do this for all non-trivial test configurations, and the easiest way to obtain a test configuration is just take X cross C. Maybe I'll change colors here. So how to obtain a test configuration, take X cross C, blow it up along some J, which, not to complicate math, let it be a subscheme of X, okay? And basically, by composition, you have the right kind of map to see. So this on the zero fiber, yeah. And you know, you can just find many different subschemes and get this, and computing the Donaldson-Futak invariant for each of them is not something doable. So I mean, of course, there are a lot of techniques that have been developed since, but the point I'm trying to get across is that obtaining something for all dimensions describing K-stability in an explicit term is something hard to imagine at the moment. Okay, so my theorem today requires something called the gap conjecture. Okay, my theorem doesn't require this conjecture to hold. My proof does. But when we first proved it, there was no other way of doing it without going through this. So I'm just going to include it. And the conjecture is open anywhere, and it's interesting to solve many of these problems. Okay. So someone asked, Andrea asked, okay, if you ask on the chat, I may see it or I may not. So if I don't reply relatively soon, just ask me, okay? So Andrea asked if I can make an explicit example of the theorem of Odaka, Li, Wang, Su for surfaces of or trifolds. And the answer is, okay, so there are proofs of what this should be for all surfaces and some trifold. So first of all, if there's no moduli, there's no much to say. Yeah, like you take the pezzo surfaces in, okay, so for degrees, what is it, 5 to 9, there's only one smooth element. So that's it, that's the moduli space. For higher degrees, there is indeed a description of what is the compactification that in fact predates the theorem of Li Wang Su and Odaka. So let me, maybe before I come into this, I was told I should be able to move this. Oh, unintended consequence. Okay. Yeah, so examples I call them examples, but they are like papers in the Journal of Differential Geometry. Examples by Odaka, Spotti, Sun, explicit description, maybe I'll just write. So description for del pezzos, all of them, okay? But for instance, in degree one, they cannot say if the compactification is projective, which is interesting. Another example by, right, let me get this straight. I think it was Spotti Sun. Del pezzo variety of degree 4, so these are intersection of quadrics in any dimension. They also gave a description, it actually coincides with the G81 one. And Spotti Sun plus, I think, is Li Su or Liu Su. So I'm going to just write LX, definitely Su and someone else. They did a degree 3, okay, they did cubic 3 folds. Cubic three folds. I have one for another threefold family, but I'm still writing up the proof, so I just announced that I have a similar one. So the whole point of this is that in all these cases, what they do is they construct a GIT compactification, and then they show that it either coincides with the K-stable compactification, or they obtain the K-stable one by doing some rational modification to the GIT compactification. And all these methods for varieties use many of the ideas that we're going to use here. They use essentially this moduli continuity method, which actually, until our paper, no one actually wrote what would be the steps that you more or less have to satisfy. But all of them follow that. So, yeah. So the method is not super original. Maybe the most original ideas here is that we did it for log pairs. Okay, and the point for log pairs, but maybe I didn't make across enough here, is that because of these Donaldson-Futak invariants, they depend on the beta, the compactifications will depend on the beta, but actually they are discretized. Like there are only certain jumps when the compactification changes. Okay, so gap conjecture. So if P is KLT singularity, okay, in particular, so by singularity I mean it's definitely not smooth, okay, of an n-dimensional variety W, then something known as the normalized volume of W is strictly is smaller or equal than 2 n minus 1 to the power of n. And it's called Kapp conjecture because so for, you know, if P was smooth, then this normalized volume would be strictly larger than this number. It's actually an explicit number that I don't remember. And hence, there is a gap between what the normalized volumes can achieve. Don't worry too much about the word normalized volume. It's an invariant of the singularities that essentially measures the difference, measures the local volume around the singularity. Yeah. Okay, so our theorem, so Gallardo, myself, and Spotti from 2018 say let D be larger or equal than n plus 1, and assuming in the Gauss conjecture there is some beta 0 between 0 and 1. Yeah, by the way, interrupt as much as you want. This is not a problem. So you have a question, please ask me. So yeah, assuming the Gauss conjecture and a degree bigger or equal than n plus 1, for all beta in between this beta 0 and 1, the K-polystable compactification that I will call it NK bar of pairs PN 1 minus beta D, where D is a hypersurface of degree D, is canonically isomorphic to M bar GIT of hypersurfaces of degree D. Okay. And then the conjecture, before I make some remarks about this, the conjecture that we posed when we saw this in the same paper is that if X is K polystable Fano variety, any singularities, okay, but K polystable, for sufficiently divisible and large number L, there is some beta zero, which depends only on X and L, says that the set of K polystable pairs MK bar, okay, the set of K polystable pairs, hang on, let me rewrite this. So really the word we use is moduli, but I guess I would have to justify this is a moduli space, which I won't do. But just take from me that this is the moduli MK bar of K polystable pairs X1 minus beta D is canonically isomorphic to the GIT compactification of this space. So you see where the equivalence between these two, I mean, you see where the conjecture generalizes the theorem a little bit. Any hypersurface D can be considered a pluri-anticanonical section of Pn. So any hypersurface D can be considered a pluri-anticanonical section of Pn. So basically we're just looking at this here. Oh, I guess I didn't say it. We're looking at this here, which are in minus L Kx. And I guess the depth of this is that this space MK bar compactifies pairs x, compactive is the moduli of pairs x1 minus beta d for d in here, but you don't know a priori that in order to compactify, you're not going to have to add other pairs x, x prime that are different than x. So let me make this explicit. So the point, to show the conjecture at the same point, the point of the conjecture is the following. One can always compactify a smoothable family of pairs x1 minus beta di, so that is vary of k polystable pairs, but this may be by adding pairs x prime 1 minus beta di prime with x prime different than x. Okay, so what we conjecture is that this doesn't happen, and in fact that's the hardest part of the theorem. Show that, you know, when you compactify, what you add at the boundary has to be pairs where the variety is Pn. Okay, we have further anecdotical evidence of the conjecture by looking at some singular cubic surfaces and L to be one, so that we only look at anticanonical sections. Okay. So these are like remarks only. So one more remark, our theorem without the gap conjecture assumption was later proven by Asher, Devleming, and Liu in about a year afterwards. Yeah. Okay. Right. So I don't. What do I have? Like another 15 minutes? Is that right?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Okay. So maybe I'll mention what the proof idea is, and then I promise in the abstract I would talk about another compactification that we describe using this method. So maybe I'll just state the theorem for that one. So what's the proof idea? So the proof idea is the moduli continuity method, which, as I said, was used before for doing K-polystable varieties, where the beta equals one, so there's no boundary. Okay. So this was first used by Odaka, Spotti, Sun. I think the paper is from 2014, although the archive version may be from 2012. So the first step is to have. This doesn't only work for like JIT compactifications. Like you find your compactification through other means that you can express. So have a compactification that we understand. So by understand is, you know, more or less everything that's inside. Which for the purposes of this example is going to be the JIT compactification. For us, it's going to be the JIT compactification of hypersurfaces in Pn. Okay. But for simplicity, I'm just going to write M variety, okay. So that's like part zero, to have a good candidate. You can't really explicitly express what's in a compactification if you don't know already what you expect to find with respect to finding it. Okay, so step one, you show that if x1 minus beta d in your K-moduli compact, in your K-polystable compactification, it's inside it, then you need to show that the same pair is somewhat represented in your M varieties. So for us, this consisted of showing that the X is must be, if X is in M chi bar, then X must be Pn and D must be given by a hypersurface. Okay. And we did this, this was the hardest bit. I mean, it's only like a paragraph or so, but because the gap conjecture is very powerful and because we use real sledgehammers for this. So we use the gap conjecture, Chen and Sun proof. That came, or a part of their four papers, and then a result by Kobayashi and I didn't copy this. Ochi, a result of Kobayashi and Ochi, saying that if something is, if a variety is biholomorphic to Pn. Sorry, saying that if you have a degeneration from a Fano variety to Pn where the Fano index is preserved, then it has to be biholomorphic to Pn. Okay, so what does that give us? That gives us that we have at least a map, okay, a map phi from this K stability to K moduli. To our Yeti, not our Yeti space, to the scheme that we take a quotient by. Okay. Actually, in our paper, to be because we use a lot of analytic techniques, we were really using the Gromov-Hausdorff compactification of the Kähler-Einstein matrix, but these two, we know they are the same, but Li Wan-Su and Odaka, it's just one has the algebraic structure and the other one doesn't. Okay. So what's the second step? Recall that something is K-stable or K-polystable if the Donaldson-Futaki is positive for all non-trivial or non-isomorphically trivial test configuration. So recall that the Donaldson-Futaki was the Hilbertman for weight lambda d when if lambda induces chi. Okay. So what does this mean? It means that if I have Pn 1 minus beta d with d in H, and this is K polystable, then D has to be JIT polystable. So this JIT polystable is something that people don't always say. So this is stable in the sense of Manifold. Okay, JIT is stable in the sense of Manifold. So it's represented on the quotient. So what that tells us is that we actually have our map phi. So let me call this one phi tilde. Our map phi tilde descends to the JIT quotient. Okay. Our map phi descends to the JIT quotient, okay? Because basically everything that's polystable, not only is in H, but it's also JIT polystable. So we can look at the class in the quotient and JIT bar. Okay, and then the last thing we need to do is use properties of phi. So I guess I keep correcting myself. I guess all the time I'm working with the analytic version of this. So recall, we have a map from this Gromov-Hausdorff compactification, which is the is the K-moduli, is the K-polystable compactification without thinking of the algebraic structure match to M bar GIT. And now we need to show phi is a homeomorphism. Okay, so the first thing to show is that phi is injective. So we need to find several properties of phi we need to prove. So the first property is injective, and this follows by uniqueness of Kähler-Einstein matrix. You cannot have, so how would phi not be injective if you had two Kähler-Einstein matrix for the same algebraic variety, Kähler-Einstein matrix with consingularities along the divisor for the same log pair in MGIT bar, but because the Kähler-Einstein matrix is unique, that cannot happen. So this map is indeed injective. B, you need to show it's continuous, and this follows from Luna slice theorem and Chen Donaldson Sun. C, you need to show that the image of phi is open and dense, but if this is log smooth for beta sufficiently large, so 1 minus beta sufficiently small, this automatically admits a Kähler-Einstein matrix, so it's K-polystable. And also, you know, if x 1 minus beta d is log smooth, that means that d is composed of smooth components intersecting normally. And in fact, even if you look at the reducible ones, those are dense in the GIT quotient, so this follows automatically. So if it's log smooth, it's Kähler-Einstein, so it's on the left-hand side, and if you add also the smooth, is in the GIT quotient, it's actually on the stable locus. Okay, A, B, C, D. Recall that the Gromov-Hausdorff compactification is compact by definition of the K-moduli compactification. With the analytic topology, the GIT compactification is Hausdorff, okay? So this being compact gives me that the image of phi, because phi is dense, so the image is compact, and because phi is dense, so this is compact and dense, so that means phi is surjective, okay? Now, because it's also Hausdorff, so I have phi is surjective and NJT is Hausdorff and the image is compact, so I get that phi is indeed a homeomorphism. Homeomorphism, okay. And this is basically the end of the proof. So I guess we call it a method because a lot of these steps are the same in any proof in which you want to characterize the K-polystable moduli. And what really changes is part zero, to have a compactification that we understand, okay? So that will be depending on the problem. Part one, in order to get the map from the K-stability to the H in particular, that's also very specific to the problem. Two normally follows automatically from the definition of Donaldson-Futaki, and everything else is really just following your nose through this chain of implications. Okay, I have 5 more minutes. So I normally, this theorem was like easy to prove, you're assuming like a conjecture.
Five minutes.
Okay.
I guess you have 35.
Okay. Well, great. Maybe I finish early. So bonus tracks, but really the main part of our paper. So from previous work, so what do I want to do here? So I want to think now of X being a cubic surface, and D being an anticanonical section, okay? So you can think of D as being X intersection H if H is not contained in X. Okay, so in previous work, when I started thinking I want to work in log stability moduli, I thought it was the simplest example, and I thought cubic surface and hyperplane section. And it turned out that it wasn't the simplest example. Simplest would be this one with P2 and curves, but I thought that was like too simple or not exactly what I had in mind. So we, together with Patricio Gallardo, we found 11 compactifications using GIT of pairs XD. In reality, okay, it was GIT for pairs X8, yeah, so F3 equals 0 and a hyper and a linear form, yeah, equals 0. But it turns out that in no case I had that H in the polystable locus, I never had that H was contained in X, so that induced GIT for pairs XD for actual log pairs, not just pairs of a hyperplane and a hypersurface. Okay. So once we had those 11 compactifications, using the same method, if a beta was bigger than beta 0 and smaller than 1, we showed that mk beta was isomorphic to mgit for the first compactification of those 11. So this is also with Spotti. And in that case, part one of the method, part zero obviously was hard because we had to come up with the right compactification, and that wasn't easy to figure out. Part one of the method, which remember is constructing this map from the K-polystable to H, was actually easier. Because there was no gap conjecture needed. But part two, where we saw that everything that's K polystable had to be GIT polystable, was actually hard. Why? Because you may have lambdas that don't actually induce a test configuration. So let me explain this. So suppose you have a pair XD, where D is X intersection H. Okay, so the GIT is for pairs X8. So a priori, I don't know much about it, but if X8 is in the GIT compactification, then we could show that H is not containing X, so we could think of X8 as being XD. So far, so good. Now, what happens? That when we take a one parameter subgroup lambda to SL4, yeah, which is what acts on P3, to SL4, it may happen when you act on the pair X8 lambda of T, and you let T equal to 0, you get some x prime its prime, yeah, and y should its prime intersection x prime be a divisor. And there's no reason for this. It may be that h prime goes to another hyperplane and x prime goes to, so in principle, it may happen that h prime is contained in the support of x prime. And then, you see, then lambda doesn't really induce a test configuration, because on the central fiber, you don't really have a log pair. What you have is just like something that's not even a log pair. Yeah. So we had to work a little bit more. That was a little bit more specific, and a lot of irrational geometry came in place here. And in fact, even working with equations. Yeah. Okay. So that's me. I don't think I have much more to say for today.